We're going to work through maybe a half a dozen or 10 verses today. I think we're starting at chapter 18, text 29. So just to introduce really, since the beginning of the book, since the beginning of the Gita, Krishna has made use of the idea of the gunas. The U.S. has a ton of COVID cases compared to the rest of the world. And if you were to go to a socialist country, and we kind of have a mixed political economic system. Somehow the word socialism has been given a bad rap in the U.S. But, you know, socialism is for the good of the people, for the good of society. So things like universal health care or dental care are socialist concepts. Food stamps is a socialist concept. Rental assistance, unemployment benefits, all that stuff is just straight socialism. And so although, you know, amongst God-fearing American, Trump-supporting Texans from the flyover states between the real America of the West Coast and the Northeast Quadrant, so many of these socialist ideas are intrinsic to our American society and our modern conceptions of what's fair and what's just and what's appropriate and how a society should be run. So there's this idea that, you know, we're anti-socialism in this country and we're capitalist and we're individualistic and we're not a socialist slash communist. Socialism is the interim phase. In Marxist theory of communism, socialism is where you get to communism. So we're like anti-socialist because socialism is just one step closer to communism and that's the end of the world. And we need to have a free market economy and deregulate things, and Hayek knew what he was up to, and Keynes. Yeah, Keynes was an idiot. He was a social economist who talked about the government stepping in and helping people out and governing society and spending money in times of difficulty and then withholding money and taxing in times of plenty, so that the government took the role of a steward over the financial lives of its citizens. I mean, I don't know. Social contract theory is not just a theory, it's a reality. If you take birth in any country, simply by dint of taking birth in that country, you have certain rights. For instance, you have roads to drive on, and you have schools to go to, and you have traffic lights, and a police force, and a fire department. You didn't do anything to get these things. They're just automatically there. And then that same government that gives you those things has a social contract with you. Again, that word social, having to do with groups of people and societies. That same government that gives you free rights and free things that you didn't do anything for, they also take other things away from you. For instance, you can't commit murder. So certainly that is some type of impingement on your freedom. You can't commit robbery. You can't do a law of the jungle. Might equals right. You can't occupy somebody else's land. You can't steal things. And so you get taxed. And so you can't go anywhere you want to go or do anything you want to do. That's the contract. You get some things for free, and some things without you agreeing are just taken away from you. That's social contract theory. which, you know, got kind of formalized in the 1700s. But if you think about it, it's always been the case. Anytime you have a group of people together, there's just certain mores that people agree to follow. And then if you aren't part of the founding fathers who decides on what those mores and rules are, then you're just obliged to follow them. You follow? Okay. So we do believe in social contract theory. It's part of the very fabric of any civilization. Otherwise, it becomes might equals right and the law of the jungle. Does that make sense? And you know, if you're half the population, social contract theory is totally your friend. What half of the population? No. What half of the population is super benefited? Huh? Women. Yes. Because women lack the upper body strength of men. If you look at women's squats, men have way bigger squats than women because they're way bigger. But if you actually look like a 115-pound super in shape woman and a 115-pound super in shape guy, their squats aren't that different. However, if you look at super strong female powerlifters and your average gym rat, your average gym rat's going to beat a female powerlifter when it comes to the bench press, the kind of standard measure of upper body strength. So upper body strength, well, whatever, it's only half your body. Yeah. How do you fight? You fight with your hands. And so upper body strength translates to the ability to commit significantly more violence. So this idea of a civilization with equal rights and guaranteed rights really favors women and children. Huge chunk of the population. You follow? It favors everybody. We're social mammals. We're made to work in a group. We're not lone wolves. Actually, wolves aren't even lone wolves. Wolves also form packs. And so we are social mammals, just like primates. We function best and we thrive in social groups, which means that you have to, you know, take one for the team and do what's in the best interest of the pack and create pecking orders and have a division of labor and so on and so forth. So socialism, the basic like fundamental idea of for the good of the people, is in every civilization. Social contract theory is part of every civilization. And then they, like, you know, they formalize it and wrote it up and really made sense out of it and explained it so that you could teach a class on it. And I could explain it like I just explained to you guys, you know, in the last few hundred years. 1700s, John Locke, some other guys. It's part of the fabric of our country. All the founding fathers were familiar with this stuff. It was interwoven into the Rights of Man, which was an English document in the 1600s, which predated our Declaration of Independence and our Constitution, but very much informed it. So then it really just becomes a question of how much society should be run for the benefit of people. You follow? And we tend to be towards the less regulated side of things. Our taxes are lower than a lot of democratic countries where you might pay 65, 70% in taxes at the top tier, whereas usually we top off around 45, 50%, something like that, 40%. Pay a lot less taxes. We have a lot less, you know, like Australians just have full medical, full dental for life, just living in that country. Full, everybody gets to go to college, full medical, full dental. And everybody can get the dole, which is Social Security. Just if you don't have a job and you're, you know, good for nothing, indolent, then you can get money forever from the government. We certainly don't have that in the U.S. Food stamps are like this, and unemployment is, you know, barely enough to scrape by an existence on. We did do a big socialism thing with all those free checks, and even Trump was doling those things out. Yeah, and nobody complained about it. Nobody was like, no, this is unfair. I mean, Trump claimed $4 million in losses at his golf courses in England and got all sorts of money from the government, got all sorts of relief. And so as soon as it comes your time to stand up with your hand out and get a free meal, everybody's cool with it. Even big corporations, that became a whole thing with COVID. The big corporations were getting multi-million dollar bailouts when they didn't need it, and then they get called out, they get canceled. But nobody really got canceled. There's like 15 minutes of fame. You'd probably be hard pressed to remember anybody who did that. Maybe if you definitely couldn't remember three companies who did it. And so everybody's taking those handouts. And every once in a while, somebody say, no, we're not taking it. But I'm sure they did the math and they figured that their credibility would earn them more in earnings than taking the free handout because they didn't qualify for much. I'm sure they were doing that kind of math. They had their accountants doing that kind of math. But anyway, we're socialist. And so now it becomes a question of how socialist are we? And in the US, we're a little less socialist than everybody else. That's why we have the Second Amendment, which is just no country in the world that's not in the midst of a civil war has Second Amendment rights like the U.S. does, has the right to bear arms like the U.S. does. We want to be able to carry assault rifles. We want everybody to be able to own assault rifles with big monster clips in case the zombie apocalypse comes down your street. Like a handgun's not enough, a shotgun's not enough, a long gun isn't enough. You need an assault rifle, like a military grade assault rifle with all the bells and whistles. Honestly, I don't even know how they got rid of the 3-round burst or automatic fire capabilities. I'm surprised that we were able to pass that kind of legislation. But if you look at a good semi-automatic rifle, you know how to double tap and you know how to do that bump thing, it's for all intents and purposes, you can fire 20 rounds in 10 seconds. And it's not that big of a deal. It's you know, even if you're not a fully automatic weapon. And then we have gun deaths to equal that. I think we have tens of thousands of gun deaths a year compared to a country like England, which has like 3 or 4 in a year. Now their population is way less. But if you adjust for our population, we're still hundreds of times more deadly than they are. Because they just decided nobody gets to carry guns. Their police don't even carry guns. And so there's a lot more knife attacks and stuff like that, but they're just way less deadly. Knife attacks are more intimate. You got to get up close and personal. You got to touch your opponent, really get close to him. Gun attacks, you can do it from a safe distance. It creates distance. It's a lot more impersonal. It's a lot easier to do it because you feel it a lot less because you're not holding the person and having to, attack them physically. We have just so many more murders, so much more gun violence compared to other countries. And they just decided, no, can't have guns at all. In England, if you don't have a gun, you can't keep it at your house. You have to keep it at a facility that you then go and check it out and then go shooting and then take it back and have it locked up again. So we're really into our freedom. We have a lot of socialism stuff going on. We're really into our freedom. And and this plays out with COVID because it seems just fundamentally wrong to make anybody get a vaccination or to deny people any rights because they're unvaccinated. It seems like it should be a personal decision. But for a socialist country, like a heavy socialist communist country, I mean, even China's not communist, but for a heavy socialist country like China, they just lock down a city. They just say, oh, you guys are all getting sick? Okay, no one's allowed to leave. We'll come by for a few days and, bring you groceries or whatever, or let one person out of your house every, 6 days. Otherwise, just stay in your house and don't come out. And then nobody goes out because it's China. I mean, if I was in China and the government said, don't go out of your house, I wouldn't go out of my house. In the U.S., you wouldn't do that. You'd be like, who are you to tell me what to do? But if I went to China or Singapore or, you know, I would just do what you're told, because the consequences, it's very clear. Their conception of reality is the good of the people is more important than the good of the individual. It's very much of a collective idea. They still have a ruling class and all that stuff, just like Russia did. It's in a lot of ways, the idea of communism is just an idea. It doesn't actually work. People are more fortunate or less fortunate, and you know, it just becomes government. Instead of being rich, making you more fortunate, it's being higher placed in the government. And even China has a mixed economy. So as did Russia. Russia also, people didn't know this, but there was Kulaks. The Kulaks owned more than 8 acres of land in the 30s. They wiped them all out. But even then, Stalin's theory was that they would allow for small businesses and they would just control all the major industry. Oil, coal, you know, gas, water, electric, copper, zinc, metal, steel, that kind of stuff. But they allowed for small business owners all throughout the USSR. They had small business owners. You just couldn't get too big. China is way more progressive in terms of its economic policy. But anyway, you get these ideas about what are people's fundamental rights? How should things be done? And if you're born into a country at a certain period of time, then it's a given. You don't even bother questioning it, whether what you believe is right or wrong. It's a plausibility structure, and you're born into and you inherit with your mother's breast milk a certain idea about what is right and what is wrong and the nature of reality. If you were born 50 years ago in this country, 100 years ago in this country, most people thought you were going to hell if you weren't a Christian. If you're born nowadays, that idea seems really arcane, and your average person doesn't think that way. If you were born 50 years ago, there were two sexes, and there were two genders, and it was decided by your chromosomes. And you just look it up, and you can look at somebody's equipment, or check their chromosomes if you want to get really fancy, if it got a little confusing. Although there might have been a few intersex individuals. 99.99% of the population fit neatly into one or two categories. You're born nowadays, the idea that gender is totally separate from your sex is normative. It's normative. You follow? And so the idea that you can be cisgender, or you can be gender fluid, or you can be transgender, or you can be non-binary, you don't want to identify with gender at all. That's considered to be just totally normal, and the idea that you get to choose your gender, and it's a choice, or it's innate, and you get to just decide what it is, and you are the ultimate arbiter of deciding what your gender is. That is rock-solid plausibility structure. Nobody even questions that. Of course, it's interesting. And I'm just ever the contrarian, so here we go. If we say that sex and gender are different, right? Then I can say that you are a female or male, because that's your sex. And then we have to come up with another term of what gender is. You follow? But if you were to say to somebody, you are biologically, physiologically a male, and I need you to accept that. And you can be transgender if you want to be. You can be gender fluid if you want to be. But you aren't allowed to choose what your sex is, because that's biological and physiological. And you've said that gender and sex are different. Therefore, I get to determine what your sex is based on your chromosomes. You don't. And you can determine this thing called gender, which is up to you. But I get to, with science, determine what your sex is. Would anybody accept that? No. It's an argument that gender and sex are separable until you start to run with that and be like, okay, fair enough. You figure out what you want to call gender, but your sex is male or female, and that's what you have to put on driver's license. Did you follow that? Nobody agrees to that. They say they're two different things, but then they say, But somehow the fact that I'm allowed to choose this one somehow influences this one. Did you follow that? That's some sleight of hand. It's not even particularly fancy. You guys never thought about that, right? Did that one ever occur to you? That particular argument? I don't think so. Really? Because I just saw that today. No, we've talked about other things in this nature where I've tried to collapse the distinction between gender and sex and say you can't really separate them. That's a different argument. This is an argument that let's go ahead and give you all of this one, but then I get this one. It's a different argument. You see it now? It's interesting, isn't it? Why have we never thought of that? Because it's a plausibility structure. If you're born at this time, it just becomes, this is what's going. This is what everybody believes. And those ideas change over time. And so we have ideas here, you know, we should be allowed to do whatever we want. And then people who are more social, so like, no, there's a line. And then, you know, you can vaccinate me when you stick a needle in my cold, dead arm. It's like, you can have my gun when you pry it out of my cold, dead hand. You can vaccinate me when you stick a needle into my cold, dead arm. You got those people on one side, and then you've got the good of the people, and we're all in this together on the other side. It's kind of two polarized parties. And parties tend to become more polarized over time because the far extremes of those parties then pull everybody in their direction. And so the parties become more distinct as time goes on. And centrist politics are very difficult. And the Obermann window gets more and more difficult to maintain, which is the idea that you have to be in the middle so you kind of get the main majority of people. So anyway, there was a plausibility structure at work all throughout the Gita. And that is that there's something called the gunas, and that the gunas are real. And so you're cool, just do your thing. Don't freak out. And so, the whole gunas thing is very foreign to us. But the guna theory is really simple. It's that prakriti, matter, is different than purusha, or spirit, that there's fundamentally two things in the world. There's spirit and there's matter. And that matter really defines everything which you see existing and going on. And that the purusha isn't just a transcendent being living in this world. In a lot of ways, it's a passenger. And you have a heck of a lot less free will than you think you do. And you're not even the driver of the chariot, if we give the analogy of the body as a chariot and the horses as the senses. You're not even the driver. You're the passenger. The intelligence and the mind are the driver and the reins. But you're actually the passenger. Most ideas, even of spirit and matter, would still have you being the driver of your body. But the model in the Katha Upanishad is that you're the passenger, and the intelligence is the driver, and the minds are the reins, horses are the senses, chariot is the body. And so the gunas are the first evolutes of prakriti, and they define all existence, and everything fits into the guna model. Everything is influenced by the gunas. Nothing isn't influenced by the gunas. And Krishna actually starts using the idea of the gunas as early as the third chapter. And he speaks about being nishtraguna, free from the three gunas. Guna atita, beyond the gunas. Nirguna, you know, no gunas. But those are all things you have to fight for through self-realization, because the natural thing is that you are bound by the gunas, and they define every aspect of your life. What aspects? The food you like, the kind of religion you're attracted to, your mentality, your personality type, the type of austerities or religious performances you follow, the kind of charity you give, everything, the clothes you wear, where you live, the kind of job and the kind of work you're attracted to. All these things are defined by the gunas. Does that free you of responsibility? Not ultimately. But it's not completely not true. And so we very much see people that are products of their conditioning, and they lack a substantial amount of free will and their, genes. And their upbringing and their environment are huge factors. Of course, modern genetics and epigenetics and science is bearing this out more so now than ever. 50% of really serious depression is hereditary. It's caused by your genes. Another 20% is caused by the circumstances which you grow up over which you have no control. 30% you can work on. 70% of major, serious, severe depression is caused by things outside of your control. Who would have thought that, right? And so this idea of the gunas through genetics and epigenetics, how genes express themselves, through a nature versus nurture argument, through the massive effect that your environment has on you, the idea is being borne out. And it really chafes. It goes against the essence of what it means to be an American, which is the idea of freedom. Freedom, that word freedom is probably the most powerful word in the American English vocabulary. In fact, if you're running for political office in this country, every politician speaks of freedom over and over again. And if you're a Republican, it's like you can't go two sentences without talking about freedom. You know, and you get to preserve your freedom, attacks on our freedom. It's just like, and it's been like that since the beginning. I mean, Benjamin Franklin talks about it. Everybody talks about it. All men are created equally and are endowed by their creator with certain inalienable rights, such as life, liberty. There it is, liberty, freedom. It's right there. It's second to life. Like the only one that gets in the door ahead of freedom is life. And the gunas fly in the face of that because they say so much of your reality is defined by the gunas. Now you do have an incredible freedom. You have the ability to identify with the gunas or not. And so by not identifying with the gunas, you become not freed from them, but you become aloof from them so that the prison house may hold your body, but it doesn't hold your soul. So Krishna, it's like from the third chapter onwards, every chapter, the idea of the gunas comes up. There is a whole chapter, Triguna Vibhag Yoga. The 14th chapter is dedicated specifically to the gunas. And then every chapter subsequently really makes use of the gunas, even more so than the first 13 chapters. But it's also in there. And so it's a ubiquitous, all-pervasive feature of the Gita, this idea of the gunas. And I have a really simple definition of the gunas for today. And that is that some things are uplifting, some things are mediocre, which means they keep you at the status quo, and some things are degrading. And when you're looking through life and you're doing things, you can think, does this uplift me? Does it keep me like in the pack, like a sheeple? Or does it degrade me? However, uplifting does not mean heaven, because there's no stairway to heaven. And so the concept of divine grace is also ubiquitous and all-pervasive throughout the Gita. And to fully transcend the gunas, you require a dose of divine grace. You require some assistance. That's not even true. To fully achieve self-realization, you require a dose of divine grace. However, the Gita does not make an argument that you absolutely can't transcend. Krishna makes the argument in the Bhakti Yoga. Mamsha yovya vicharana bhakti yogena sevate. By practicing Bhakti Yoga. Bhakti yogena sevate. Sevate means you practice. What do you practice? Bhakti yogena, with Bhakti Yoga. How do you do it? Avyabhicharana, unwaveringly, with Bhakti Yoga, you practice. Who are you doing that to? Mam, Yah, one who does that for to me. They have bhakti for me unwaveringly. Sagunan samatitaita. They transcend the gunas. Sagunan samatitaityan. Gun atita. And so atita means they go beyond completely. Samatitaityan. Etan. These gunas, they go beyond them. Brahma bhuyaya kalpate. They become Brahman. So Krishna does actually recommend in the chapter about the gunas that's called Triguna Vibhag Yoga, the yoga of the three gunas. At the end of that chapter, Krishna recommends bhakti yoga as the way to transcend the gunas. That said, I do think it's possible in the Gita to transcend the gunas. I mean, there's other verses. Daiva hi esha guna mayi. Daiva hi esha. These gunas, these divine gunas, they're actually divine. Mama maya of mine. They are duratya, they're difficult to cross. Mameva ye prapadyante. But those who approach me, mayame tantarantite, they're able to cross over them. And so, over and over again, Krishna actually recommends service to him, surrender to him, a connection with him, as being what helps you transcend the gunas. However, Krishna does say, you know, Vishaya, Triguna Vishaya Veda, the Vedas are about three gunas, Nishtrigunya Bhavarjuna, be free from the gunas. Nishtrigunya Bhavarjuna, be free from the gunas. Nirdvandva, be free from duality. Nitya Sattvasta, and be situated in pure goodness, in pure existence. So Krishna does sometimes just tell you, be free from the gunas. And sometimes he says, you have to surrender to me to be free from the gunas. So you could make an argument that it's not absolutely required that you surrender to Krishna to get free from the gunas. It's a quick way to do it. It's like an escalator. It takes you up to the top really quickly. But it's like an escalator. It's also a rocket ship. It takes you beyond what the stairs could take you to. The stairs might take you to the top of the building, but an escalator come rocket ship is going to take you to the top of the building quick, and it's going to take you beyond the building. Whereas of your own endeavor, there is a ceiling on how high you can climb in being free from the gunas. The important point is that sometimes sattva guna, the best guna, the uplifting guna, is thought of, if I just cultivate sattva guna, that's going to lead to transcendence. But Krishna makes it clear that sattva guna will not lead to transcendence. Because he says, tatra sattvam nirmalatva prakashakam anamayam sukha sangena badnati jnana sangena chanaga. That sukha sangena badnati, it binds you. Badnati, it binds you. How does it bind you? Sukha sangena, by making you happy, by making you attached to happiness. Jnana sangena cha anaga. And it also binds you to knowledge. So the very knowledge that the mode of goodness gives you, the mode of sattva gives you, the very knowledge and happiness that it gives you, actually binds you to this world because you become attached to it. And therefore, it's like a maelstrom, like a whirlpool, where even if you get sucked up to the surface and you're floating on the top, eventually in due course of time, you're going to get sucked back down. So we've looked over the last three, four chapters, it's just all been about the gunas. Have you guys noticed that? And it's just going to continue today. It's going to continue today. And so Krishna is going to define three more things according to the gunas. Here we go. Now please listen as I tell you in detail of the different kinds of understanding and discrimination according to the three modes of material nature. So Krishna's going to tell us about buddhi and dritti. Dritti means determination, and buddhi means enlightenment. So, buddher bedham drittesh chaiva. The distinction of buddhi and also dritti. Gunatas trividham shrinu. Listen to me as I describe the three divisions, trividham, like tricycle, trividham, the three kinds of beta distinctions, gunata, of the gunas, with relationship to buddhi and dritti, intelligence and fortitude or determination. Prochamanam asheshena. This will be described completely. Prithakvena, with all of its divisions. All right. So what are we describing now, according to the gunas? Buddhi and dritti. What is buddhi? Intelligence. And what is dritti? Say it with me. Dritti. What is dritti? Fortitude, determination, steadfastness, that kind of stuff. Conviction. All right? The understanding, that understanding by which one knows what ought to be done and what ought not to be done, what is to be feared, what is not to be feared, what is binding and what is liberating, is in the mode of sattva. So that buddhi, which understands, which veti, which knows, same place you get the word Veda from, which knows. What does it know? Pravritim cha nivritam. What should be done, what should not be done. Akarya, karya. What should not, again, what should, pravritti and nivritti means like, Prabhupada merges it together. He says, what ought to be done and what not ought to be done. But that's karya and akarya. And so, pravritti and nivritti means what you should turn towards and what you should turn away from. Literally. What you should do and what you shouldn't do. Bhaya abhaya, what you should fear, what you should not fear. Bandha, what is it? Bandha moksham cha, yeah. And that which is liberating and which is binding. I'm pretty sure the word bind comes from bund, which means to bind in Sanskrit. Fairly sure those words are etymologically linked. I've never looked it up in an etymological dictionary, but just based on the B and the N and the D together like that, I'm fairly certain they're the same verbal root. Binding and liberating. So that's sattvic. So if your intelligence allows you to understand what should you do, what should you not do, what should you turn towards, what you should turn away from, what's binding, what's liberating, then your intelligence is sattvic. Which sounds like it should take you back to heaven, but it doesn't. It's not bad. Gets you up, top of the building, but it doesn't take you back home. Now, the buddhi which cannot distinguish between religion and irreligion, dharma and adharma, between action that should be done and should not be done, karya and akarya, like the previous verse. So the last one was you do know what should be done, what should be done. This one is, and then finally, let's see here. So prajanati. Prajanati. Ayatavat. You incorrectly understand. You know incorrectly. You incorrectly decipher what you should do and what you shouldn't do, what's dharma and what's adharma. You don't correctly decipher it. That, of course, would indicate that sometimes you might get it right, sometimes you might get it wrong, but you're fuzzy on it. That's rajasic. That's in the mode of rajas. It's dusty. The word rajas literally means dusty. So you're dusty. Sometimes you get it right, sometimes you get it wrong. And then the last one, that understanding which by which one considers dharma to be a dharma, under the spell of illusion and darkness, and strives always in the wrong direction, that's in the mode of ignorance, tamas, darkness. So now, your manyate, he thinks, tamasa avrita, covered by tamas, darkness. Adharma, dharma iti ya. He thinks that adharma is dharma. He thinks that irreligion is religion. He thinks that like what you shouldn't do is what you should do. Sarvatan viparitangs cha buddhi. His, in all circumstances, it's always going in the wrong direction. In everything you do, for every purpose, you're doing the wrong thing. So tamas, darkness, is really just a more intense version of the basic problem of RUGIS, the lack of clarity in RUGIS. Just like if you make something, if something's transparent, one translation of sattva might be transparent or clear. And as it gets dusty, it gets more translucent, which means light can get through it, but it's not fully transparent. You follow? But if you keep on making it less and less translucent, what happens eventually? It gets opaque, and light can't pass through it at all. Rajas is translucent. Sattva is transparent. Tamas is opaque. There are three different places on the same continuum. So have you ever met somebody where everything they want to do is wrong? Where every time they open their mouth, they say something stupid? They never get it? You can explain to them exactly, and you say, what did I just say? And they'll just say the exact wrong thing. But like with gusto, with confidence, like they really feel like they got it. You know what I'm talking about? That's tamas. And then you see somebody where, you know, sometimes they get it right, sometimes they get it wrong. Why do they sometimes get it right and sometimes get it wrong? Usually it's because they're too attached. They got a vested interest. And so they can't see things clearly because they got too much riding on, they're too attached. The basic feature of rajas is attachment. The basic feature of sattva is detachment. Still, sattva has a little bit of attachment to knowledge and happiness. So it still manages to drag you down, but not the way rajas is just, it's like 50-50. Flip of a coin. You make terrible decisions. Because you're not making decisions based on what's right, what's going to get you where you need to go. You're making decisions based on what's going to be enjoyable. What's going to get you where you need to go in some ultimate sense. What's healthy for you. Does that make sense? All right. So that's buddhi. I think that these verses have as much pragmatic value today as they did when they were spoken. I think focusing on getting lucidity and clarity in terms of what you should and shouldn't do, what's right and wrong, which direction should you turn towards, which direction should you turn away from. I think that is great advice for every single person on the planet. Like my 2022 resolution is I'm going to figure out what I should be turning towards and what I should turn away from. What is to be done by me and what should be let go of. And what is dharmic, what is my duty, what is my purpose, and what is adharmic, what is not for me. What a great list, right? I want to move from translucent to transparent. I definitely want to avoid the opaqueness. And most people, this happens where you know, on a bad day, you feel your powers of cognition, your powers of discrimination. Buddhi is really discrimination. Mana, mind, is thought. Buddhi is the ability to discriminate between various types of thoughts. That's why the minds are the reins and the buddhi is the driver. Because the buddhi is the ability to sort through your thoughts and regulate them and discriminate between them and choose what to think about. It's a higher cognitive process. It's able to rule the lower cognitive process of just thoughts and data and impressions and desires. It's able to regulate them and turn them in the right direction. As such, it represents a higher noetic feature or cognitive faculty. That was very important to make this distinction. It's funny because, you know, in some ways, old wisdom is old and lacks some of the sophistication of modern science. But in this regard, I think that the Vedic wisdom actually had more insight into the workings of the human mind. And really, it was able to instantiate in its community the idea that you're not your thoughts. I don't think that is a standard idea, let's say, like, for instance, in the US. I do think your average cab driver, like your average rickshaw wala in India, if you ask him, are you your thoughts? He'll say no. Are you your body? No. Are you your thoughts? No. So when you're looking at plausibility structures of what we choose to instantiate at birth or in the early years into our society, this is a wild idea. You're not your thoughts. Your thoughts don't own you. I mean, how liberating is that idea? The very concept of buddhi is that it allows one to discriminate between thoughts and pick and choose and sculpt your internal world of thought. Your internal world of thought can be sculpted just like your body can be sculpted. So you can work out your body and you can sculpt your body. You can also sculpt your mind, cultivate your mind. Use your mind as a friend instead of an enemy. A controlled mind is your friend. An uncontrolled mind is your enemy. Bandhu and ripu. Ripu means enemy. Bandhu means friend. Literally, someone you're bound to. The same word, bind. Bund. Someone you're bound to. And so the mind can be your bandhu or your ripu, according to Gita. If you've controlled it, it's your friend. If it's uncontrolled, it's your enemy. Okay, so we got your intellect, your power of discrimination. We've understood the limits of the gunas in terms of transcendence. We've understood a really basic idea of uplifting, mediocre, and down. And certainly, most people sometimes know what they should do, sometimes they don't know what they should do. The more attached they get to a given circumstance, the less good decisions make. You get this sunk cost fallacy that everybody gets susceptible to, where they invest in something and they keep putting into it, even though it's like dead as a door. Now, anybody objectively standing outside the circus can see it, but you're in it, so you're like, oh, I'll just keep putting money in. The sunk cost fallacy. They don't have the ability to just look at something, is this worth doing or not? They factor all the time they put into it. And they don't see when it's not a good investment, and they think good money after bad. That's attachment and how it leads you to not see things clearly. So these ideas actually work their way into economic theory and critical thinking theory. Amazing. Like my son was just like, hey dad, you know what the sunk cost fallacy is? I'm like, yeah son, I knew about it, you know, before you were a twinkle in my eye. And so he's like, I don't believe he was taking, you know, logic class or economics. I think it was maybe economics. And so, you know, even economics is ultimately quite theoretical and quite philosophical. And so you like discover this little nugget, and you know, we toss it around, and you know, and explore it together. Okay. So then, what's next? We got. That determination which is unbreakable, which is sustained with steadfastness by yoga practice, and which thus controls the activities of the mind, life, and senses, is determination in the mode of goodness. Okay, so now we got dritti. Dritti from dri, which means to hold. We're actually where we get the word dharma from. Actually, same root as the word dharma. I never looked that up, but I'm certain of it. I'll look it up after class. That was when I could actually look up bun too. But I'm certain dri is where you get the word dritti from. That determination by which mana, prana, indriya, kriya, the activities of your mind, your prana, and your indriyas, the activity of your mind, your life, air, and your senses, the kriya, the activities of these things, dharyate, you're able to sustain it, you're able to hold it, same root, dri, again, dharyate, one is able to restrain or hold fast, that dritti, by which you're able to, by which you're able to do that, that is dritti sattviki, that dritti is sattvik, and that dritti is yogena avyabhicharinya. That dritti, same word I quoted before, unflinching. When I said avyabhicharinya bhakti yogena, how do you transcend the gunas? By bhakti yoga, unflinching. So here you have this unmoving, unwavering yoga practice. That dritti, which by unwavering yoga is able to control the mind, the life air, and the senses, that's dritti, which is sattvic. And so your buddhi and your dritti work together. Your buddhi is the capacity to discriminate, and your dritti is this additional feature which allows you to fully exercise your buddhi. You follow? So it's actually like, in some ways you could say buddhi almost implies dritti, because your faculty of being able to control your thoughts, right, would seem to imply dritti. But here they're being defined separately. And so we could say that your ability to discriminate is your thoughts, is your mind. Your ability to distinguish between thoughts is your buddhi, which can be cultivated. And the thing which allows you to cultivate that buddhi is your dritti, your determination, which then allows you to restrain yourself and keep your mind focused on where it needs to go. In this sense, dritti and buddhi are very close cousins. They're kissing cousins. They're like two peas in a pod. They're meant to go together. Dritti gives strength to buddhi. You can have good thoughts. You can discriminate, in the good sense of discriminate. Not like I discriminate against women and children. Like I discriminate against, you know, I'm a discernment, I think it's probably a better word. Discrimination has been, you know, owned by the civil rights movement. And so you probably can't use the word discriminate in a positive sense anymore, although, from a vocabulary, a dictionary definition, the denotation of the term is still neutral. But I think the appropriate term nowadays we have to replace discrimination with, so people don't freak people out, is discernment. And so you can discern, but then how will you be able to stay strong in your discernment, right? And that's where the dritti comes in. It's like the fuel or the strength behind that cognitive faculty. Does that make sense? So it's a very fine way of thinking about your internal cognitive processes. It's a very nuanced way of thinking about it. We normally just kind of lump it all together. I am my thoughts, my desires, my feelings. It's all just kind of one mash, and I just go wherever they tell me to go and do whatever they tell me to do. This idea is like, you know, your mind might have a thought, you're like, oh, you know what, just let that thought go. And then like, what will strengthen my ability to let that thought go? What do I need to cultivate? That steadfastness, that determination. That's an important thing to cultivate. Also, alongside my power of discernment, I also need to cultivate the ability to execute that power of discernment, to stay with that power of discernment. You know, think of a physical corollary. It would be like, you develop flexibility and strength through yoga, right? Which allows you to control your body. That's the intelligence allowing you to control your mind. But then the determination to do your yoga practice every day is yet another thing. Did you follow that? That would be like a corollary. It's not perfect, because one's a mental thing and the other one's physical, but these are both mental. But I think that it conveys the idea. Any questions on this? Of course, if you want to be a Hare Krishna, we have to have unbreakable determination. We convince you to chant 16 rounds, which takes 2 hours, and then tell you you should do that every day for the rest of your life. And then we tell you to follow the four regular principles, which is, you know, it's pretty easy if you're an Indian, but like at least if you're a super pious Indian. But the four regular principles, you know, vegan, sober, celibate, no gambling. That's no joke. It's no joke. And so then we convince people to do that, and then we tell them, oh, do that forever. When the devotees first took initiation from Srila Prabhupada in 1966, he held the first initiation ceremony right around Janmashtami time. He did not tell them what they were vowing to do. And so then he posted the four regular principles on a mimeograph sheet some days later at the temple. A mimeograph was like a primitive copying machine. It would be like kind of a greenish blue ink on the page. And so the devotees like saw it and they were like, oh. Like they were like, geez, it's like no joke, you know? So they got initiated, Prabhupada gave them initiation and then told them the rules they had to follow to be his disciples. So it's like a super gangster move, right? like really edgy, right? Really pushing the envelope. That was the birth of the Hare Krishna movement, was Prabhupada duping a bunch of idiots to taking initiation, and nobody bothered to ask, what am I bound to do, Srila Prabhupada? They're just like, yes, Swamiji, and he's like, okay, here. Also, he didn't just sit down and tell them what the rules were. That was also a super slick move. He just wrote them down and said, go run some copies of this off and post it. They said at that point, they were like hiding in the coffee shop. They would go get like a donut and coffee, and then they would put their heads down, like the Prabhupada couldn't see him when he was walking by in the morning time. And then they saw this sheet and was like, ah, oh, we're going to have to really change our lives now. But that determination by which one holds fast to fruitive results in religion, economic development, and sense gratification is of the nature of rajas. So, dharma, karma, artan, dritya, dharate, prasangena, palakangshi. You are attached and desiring the fruits. That determination, which you're involved in dharma, artha, and karma, you're involved in religion, and you're involved in sense gratification, and you're involved in economic development, and you're involved in that thing because you're attached and you want to enjoy the fruits of it, that determination is in the mode of rajas. So you want to run your yoga shop. You want to run your yoga studio. You're all about it. You're all about chanting Hare Krishna. You're all about being a devotee. If there's a cute girl at the temple. If your yoga shop's making money, if everybody's telling you how great you're doing, then you're enthusiastic. And you're all about it. And you're like, this is great. I'm super dedicated. And then when people are criticizing you, and when you're alone, and when there's no one around telling you how cool you are, and when it's not popular, and when it's not easy, and when the going gets tough, then you bounce, then your dritti is not. I mean, you can't count on that. You can't count on that. I mean, as long as you're like giving people stuff, they're gonna hang. You know, as long as you got the carrot, people are gonna stay with you. But then the moment something better comes along, the moment you no longer have utility to that person, the moment they think there's an easier way to get what they want, then they bounce. You know those kind of people? You might even be those kind of people. That's their determinations in the mode of rajas. It's way less steady. It's something. It might masquerade as something steady when the stars align, everything's easy. But when the going gets tough and the tough get going, other people bounce and they leave. They're over it. This is stuff that's worth thinking about. I mean, how many people visit our temples? How many people stick around? How many people stick around? How many people stick around for a long time? How many people get initiated? How many of those people get initiated actually stay with it? How many people actually make a life out of being a devotee? It's based on their determination. Now, we take these concepts and ideas like utsaha nischaya dharyat. We talk about enthusiasm and patience and determination. Nischaya, certitude, determination, very similar to this word. We talk about these terms in relation to devotional service. This exploration is not. It's about the material version of these things, the uplifting material version, the steady material version, or the degrading material version. We're talking about these same concepts within our spiritual life. So in a lot of ways, it would be a fourth entry into the text. Does that make sense? Because these are about things in the material world, but we also speak about things that go beyond this world. But the same basic concepts are there. And usually it's like the uplifting version. You just have to supercharge that uplifting version and add divine grace, and it becomes transcendent. So these ideas of cultivating determination and not just doing things when they're easy. It's something we all have to cultivate to make it in spiritual life. But even to make it in material life, you have to cultivate this. Because everything's not always going to go your way. And that determination, which cannot go beyond dreaming, fearfulness, lamentation, moroseness, and illusion. So that dhriti, which is swapna, it's dreaming, bhaya, fear, shoka, lamentation, vishada, depression, madam, confusion, na vimuchanti durmedha, it can't free itself from those things. And it's bad, it's foolish. That dhriti is in tamas, in darkness. So you get people where they just never get off the ground. Their determination is to do nothing and to be paralyzed. They're fixed in that. And maybe they have, you know, like the famous Prabhupada used to tell the story. There was a potter who had a single pot. It was like about as poor as you can get in India. Because people buy pots, eat out of them, and throw them away. And then dig. This is very, very, you know, kind of very, very, like a very low-level wage, low-level job. So he had a pot. He was thinking, I will sell this pot, and I will get two pots. Then I will sell the two pots, I will get four. And like this, I will have hundreds of pots, thousands of pots. I will buy a wheel. I'll have many wheels. Many people will be making pots for me. I'll get married. I'll have children. They will all serve me. I will be very, very rich. And if one of my children does not serve me nicely, I will kick them. And he like was thinking like this, and he was sleeping. He was dreaming like this about how rich he was going to be with his one pot. And then he kicked in his dream, and he kicked in real life, and he kicked the pot over, and it broke. So you get people like this where they have all these ideas and they don't do anything ever. That determination, which never goes anywhere. It's not like you're going for it as long as the going is good. And as soon as people criticize you, it doesn't go your way, then you bounce. That's bad. This is worse. This is like even if it's going good, you still don't do it. You're doing nothing. You're doing a whole lot of nothing. You're making plans, and they never go anywhere, and you never do anything because you're lazy and confused and bewildered. Like, laziness and inertia and sloth is your thing. And so that determination is tamas. The determination where when things are good, you stick with it, and then when things are bad, you bounce, that's rajas. And that determination where you stick with things, you're unbreakable, you're focused, you're controlled, and you just move in the right direction, and you have fortitude. That's in the mode of sattva. And then that, used for loving Krishna, then helps you. That's incredibly useful to the devotee. Does that make sense? Buddhi, dhriti, the faculty, the fuel. The ability to discern, the motivation to keep discerning and living your life like this. Three ways of modeling it. And Krishna now looking at our minds and our mindsets, along with looking at religion and food and everything else, through this model of the gunas, to communicate what an uplifting life looks like and what a degrading life looks like. And in a lot of ways, these are sectarian ideas. They are trans, you know, sect ideas. They are ideas which would be true in any religion, in any society, in any culture. They're very, very general ideas. But they're not so general as to be meaningless and just platitudes and obvious truths that everybody knows. Like a lot of times you hear people talking and they just say stuff that everybody knows. But this manages to be very obvious, very straightforward, very easy to appreciate. And at the same time, stuff you wouldn't have thought of on your own. Yes. Yes, sir.
Is procrastination related to determination?
Yeah, sure. Shoka, lamentation, vishada, despondency, Bhaya, fear, swapna, dreaming, madan, confusion, all those terms, you know, they have. I thought there was alasya was in here. Oh, that's in happiness, which is coming next. I think procrastination fits really nicely in there with dreaming, because it means it's just all going on in your mind. And so alasya would be procrastination and laziness, exactly. So this doesn't have that exact word in here, but certainly any of these things, dreaming, I mean, fear-based versus love-based, that might motivate you to act, but just acting out of fear, you're avoiding pain as opposed to achieving pleasure. Shoka, lamentation, vishada, despondency, you're sinking down. That's from shad, it means to sink down. That could be a little bit of laziness. Madan, confusion could lead to that. So 1,000% procrastination is what's intended by this. And several of the words are sisters and cousins of laziness and procrastination. And the literal term will come up in just a couple of verses. But yeah, that's the exact idea. Now hear from me about the three kinds of happiness by which the conditioned soul enjoys and by which he sometimes comes to the end of all distress. So abhyasat, from practicing this, ramate, he finds happiness, and dukantam nigachati, he goes to the end of his suffering, which is the purpose of happiness, right? The purpose of happiness is to end suffering and achieve pleasure. So there's a positive and a negative. It's avoiding pain, that is your dukkha, your suffering. Anta, nigachati, you arrive at the end of your suffering, and then ramate, and you also find joy and pleasure. So it's like you're doing stuff to become happy, or to feel pleasure, and you're doing stuff to avoid pain. It's classic behaviorism. And so there's three kinds of happiness too. Sukh, sukham, three kinds of happiness. That which in the beginning may be just like poison, but in the end is just like nectar, and which awakens one to self-realization, is happiness in the mode of sattva. So, that sattva, yat tat, that by which, agre bisham eva, in the beginning it's like poison. Pariname amrita upanam, but it turns into being just like nectar. Welcome to your New Year's resolutions, right? Tat sukham sattvikam proktam, that is called sattvik sukham, happiness that's in the mode of sattva. Atma buddhi prasadajam, it's born from self-awareness. It's born from tranquility and self-awareness. That's a wild idea, right? Atma-buddhi, self-buddhi, self-awareness. Prashadam, tranquility. Prashad means tranquility. The meaning we have of prasad, of spiritual food stuff which is offered to Krishna, or things offered to the deity, that's a secondary meaning. The primary meaning is tranquility. Prasadam jam, it's born of tranquility from self-intelligence. You find your happiness within. That happiness was derived from contact of the senses with their object. What does that mean? That means I'm happy because I smell a cool flower, because I see a beautiful thing, because I hear beautiful music. My senses touch objects, and that's where my pleasure comes from. The problem with that is your sensual power diminishes as you get older. Your libido goes down as you get older. Your eyesight goes away. Look at my eyesight. I used to be able to read in the dark. Your powers of cognition, your ability to digest the world, swallow the world through your senses goes down over time. You can't even really understand this unless you're in your 30s. You can't really understand until you hit your 40s. And you can't really, really understand until you hit your 50s. Of course, people in their 60s and 70s are saying, you can't really, 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 really understand until you hit your... And so this ability, you know, post 28, you just start to learn more and more, wow. It's not that I just grow bigger, faster, stronger forever. So that happiness which comes from sensual power, of course, in the beginning that's good, but as time goes on, it starts out like nectar, but what does it finish like? Poison. So the first one starts out like poison, finishes like nectar. This one starts out like nectar, finishes like poison. The happiness which derives from the contact of the senses with their objects and appears like nectar at first but poison at the end is said to be in rajas. So those are people who try to find their happiness through material enjoyment, and they're happy some days, they're sad other days, and then eventually they're sad all the time. Eventually they're sad all the time. And that happiness which is blind to self-realization, delusion from beginning to end. So in the beginning and the end, it's all based on delusion. And which arises from sleep, laziness, and illusion is in the mode of ignorance. So this is yat agre cha anubande cha. In the beginning and the end, sukha mohanam atmana. It's characterized by illusion from beginning to end. It's miserable from the beginning to the end. You think you're happy, but anybody else look at you, you're miserable. Like you're like, you know, like they say, like a pig rolling around in stool. The pig thinks like this is great, it's nice water and there's food to eat. But as a human being, you look at a pig in the sewer rolling around, you're like, that's disgusting. And then it is nidra alasya pramada uttam. It arises from nidra, sleep. Not even dreaming, it's sleep, alasya, laziness, pramad, madness, uttam, it comes from that, tattamasam udahritam. That is understood to be, or is considered to be, happiness in the mode of tamas. Whoa! We've gone that long? Oh, I just lost track of time. Sorry. Just lost track of time. So happiness, determination, and intelligence. Buddhi, dritti, and sukham. Sukha. Buddhi, dritti, and sukha. Happiness, determination, and intelligence. And Krishna uses this model, which was just everybody understood it and worked with it. And we can also appreciate it. It's uplifting, mediocre, or degrading. And we want to move in this realm. And then for devotees, we add to that the element of grace. We add that the element that we're using these things for Krishna, and then these things become very useful to our spiritual life. But even if you're not a devotee, these ideas are great. Even if you're not a theist, these ideas are great. They're powerful ideas. And so a frame, I mean, you could do a self-help course on this. You could do a life coaching course on this. It's really valuable stuff. I mean, how many Instagram posts you see? No one's coming. No one's going to do it for you. You got to do it yourself. You got to buckle up, Buttercup. You got to make it happen. You're going to get a lot of hate. Don't listen to them. Right? How many reels do you see like that? And you're like, oh, these guys got it, right? Here's Krishna. Krishna doing this thousands of years ago. And so it's incredible life wisdom. How to look. What is good happiness? Good happiness is long term. Good happiness is it's got some long term goals. Good happiness is as much about the journey as it's about the result. Good happiness can stand things which are difficult in the beginning because it has a longer vision. It has some executive function. It has some impulse control woven into it. It has some delayed gratification woven into it. Dritti should not be just because you get a quick result. Should not be just because people are telling you you're doing the right thing. It should be because you've really arrived at what should be done and you're fixed on it. And your discernment should be focused on transparency and really understanding what is worthy of dedicating one's life to. And that's a life worth living. And Krishna's doing some like some major therapy here. This is psychological. It's life coaching. It's inspirational. It's a mental boot camp. It's simple. It's elegant. It's powerful. It's usable. It's practical. Take it home. Use it at your dinner table tonight. Wonderful stuff. What a great way to roll in the new year. Thank you very much. Thank you, guys. All right, give me some feedback. Yeah.